Welcome back to Better Life Today. My name is Henry Martin, and you get to meet some of the most interesting people on this program. Today, our guest is an evangelist from Dallas, Texas, whose name is Mark Fox. Mark, thank you very much for coming on the program today.
It's a joy to be with you, Henry.
Yeah. What is it that prompted you to become an evangelist? When you were a youngster, did you ever dream about sharing the Word of God or what?
Well, Henry, although I was raised in a Seventh-day Adventist pastor's home, it really was the last thing on my mind. I had no idea that I would ever be a pastor or ever be an evangelist. So it was the furthest thing from my mind, especially as I'll share with you during my turbulent teenage years. So the trajectory of my life early on was not leading towards becoming an evangelist.
Well, where was it leading in that case? Did you have brothers and sisters? Did they influence you any?
Well, I'm one of four boys. I'm number two. And we grew up predominantly in the Northeast area. I was born in New Jersey. And my father pastored a number of different churches in the Southern New England Conference and in Massachusetts and Connecticut. And early on, I dropped out of high school after the ninth grade. And it was actually I who was a bad influence on my brothers and not the other way around, unfortunately. I began to make some really destructive choices early on, unfortunately.
Well, what kind of choices were they, and how did your parents respond to that?
Well, I'll quickly say my parents always responded with love and prayers, and right now I'll just interject, we're very close, we're very bonded, have a lot of common ground, as my father is retired from being a Seventh-day Adventist pastor. But yeah, some of those choices were prompted by curiosity. When I was 13, I was curious about cigarettes, and I remember smoking my first cigarette and getting dizzy and thinking, this is not cool. But I thought, well, everybody else is doing it, so let me go ahead and try. And so really it was curiosity, wanting to experiment with these different things. This was during the hippie era, so everybody was experimenting with drugs and drinking and so forth. So I dropped out of high school after the ninth grade. I acquired the wrong friends. I was actually, unfortunately, kicked out of high school, public high school, and then a Seventh-day Adventist church school in Rehoboth, Massachusetts, allowed me to come back there where I used to go to school. And I went back there and finished the ninth grade.
Did that do you any good? Did that get you on the straight and narrow?
Unfortunately, it didn't. And you know, the Bible says, today if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart, Hebrews 4, verse 7. And I just kept hardening my heart. But my parents prayed. They solicited church members to pray for me. And while my father was pastoring in Hartford, Connecticut, one of the sympathizing, compassionate church members felt sorry for the wayward pastor's prodigal son, and she got me a job as a shipper and receiver in a printing envelope company. So I did that for a number of years, and so I'm very grateful. Linda Martin, a church member there at the Hartford Seventh-day Adventist Church, got me this job. And it helped to at least give me some semblance of stability in my life. And my parents continued to pray. The church members prayed. And of course, I was not attending church, had no interest in attending church. I was very much, you know, wanting to get away from God, away from the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and much to the dismay and heartbreak of my parents. But they kept praying. And one episode that I'll share with you right away. When I was 17 years old, I was an alcoholic.
Really?
I was drinking just about every single day, taking a lot of drugs, and really down a self-destructive path.
Were you still living at home at that time?
Part of that time I was living at home. On one night, it was November 17, 1975, I was 17, And I was with my buddy Bob on his 1963 Harley-Davidson Sportster. It was a chopper, it was loud, it was fast, and it got the girls' attention. So I used to love to go cruising around, riding around with Bob on his Harley. And we were coming from a bar on our way to another bar in East Hartford, Connecticut. And we were going probably about 45 miles an hour in a 35 mile an hour posted speed zone. We were helmet protesters, letting our long hippie hair blow in the cool November breeze.
Oh, you were into that too, huh?
Unfortunately, yeah, we caught the tail end of the hippie movement. But anyway, as we began to approach a curve up in the road, sudden ominous premonition swept over me of danger lurking ahead. And as we pulled out of that curve, all of a sudden, a VW darted across our pathway, across the double yellow line, no blinker on, and they didn't even have their lights on. It was a young teenager learning how to drive with his mother. And we just, impacted, against that VW, and we were thrown like refuse to the side of the road. And as we were both sprawled out by the curb side of the supermarket, I couldn't breathe. And of course, I wanted nothing to do with God. But Henry, when I could not breathe, guess who I thought about?
Well, I'm recognizing a foxhole conversion.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, I wasn't converted at that time, but I did think about God. And I immediately looked up to the starlit sky. I couldn't breathe. And time stood still, my mind racing, and I could just think of one thing. God, please don't let me die, I said in my heart. And God heard that prayer, and I began to breathe, and with that came an overwhelming sensation of excruciating pain. And I tried to get up. I couldn't get up. Mm-hmm. And I panicked more, and I tried to get up. By this time, a crowd had gathered and were hovering over us, asking my friend Bob how he was doing. And I looked over at him, and his face was all bloodied and his bike mangled. And I tried to get up again, and I couldn't get up. And the crowd asked me, are you okay? And all I could do is grunt and groan. And it says in Proverbs 27 and verse 1, it says, don't boast about tomorrow, because you don't know what a day will bring forth.
That's true.
And so we know that life is fragile. So what happened is the ambulance arrived, and on that fast track to the Hartford Hospital, they asked me, Mark, can you wiggle your toes? Well, I had never been asked that before. So I could wiggle my toes. Bob, to my right, was having a hard time. So when we arrived at the Hartford Hospital, I was on that hard emergency board for what seemed to be an eternity. And my parents arrived, and they looked like they had seen a ghost. They were very concerned, and being a parent, I can begin to imagine how they must have felt.
They probably recognized alcohol on your breath as well.
Oh, yeah. Unfortunately, I had been drinking. And so
what kind of a heartbreak it could be for your mom?
It's interesting. Because when my father left the emergency room area that I was in to check up on Bob's medical status, when my mom and I were left alone there in that portion of the emergency room, I said, Mom, how am I doing? And she lifted up the sheet, and she was taking a look at my bruised and bleeding and battered body. And she said with a quivering, cracking voice, you're going to be okay. My mom has always loved me. And to this day, if I ever call my mom or my dad, I know what I'm going to hear on the other end. We love you. And it's always been that way ever since I was little. And so my parents prayed that I would pull out of this. And the second night I was in the hospital, I almost died. I didn't know I was almost dying, but I developed some blood clots.
Oh, really?
And, because I had a 3/4 fractured pelvis, severely sprained back, and so we developed some blood clots. I didn't know it at the time, but when my parents arrived one morning to visit me there at the Hartford Hospital, One of the church members, Pam Caruso, confronted, who worked there as a nurse, confronted my parents and said, we almost lost your son last night because of fatty emboli or blood clots. So my parents prayed for me, and I got to tell you this, it's heartbreaking, but I got to tell you the truth, that some of my friends would come in with their drugs and different things, and we would have conversation about topics that were really uncomfortable to talk about in the presence of my parents. So I asked my parents, I'm ashamed to mention this, but I want to share it for good reason. I asked my parents, please don't come and visit me. I chose my friends above my parents. And I believe it's because I chose sin. More important to me than anything is my sinful lifestyle. And fast forward, of course, now my parents and I are very, very close. A matter of fact, it never rubs off. It never wears off. They, even to this day, I'll call them, and frequently they will tell me, Mark, we're just so glad that you came back home. We're so glad you gave your heart to Jesus. And here I am many years later. But I almost died in that near-fatal motorcycle accident.
But there are some of us in this room who have experienced similar things, and there must be thousands of viewers out there all over the West who also have experienced similar kinds of events in their own life. And you could be pleased to say how God turned your life around, but you're still on a destructive mode at this point in your life.
Yeah, another episode. After I was discharged from the hospital with crutches, my mother saw that I was getting ready to go up to my friend Paul's house, who was really no better than Bob, with friends like I had. My parents, you know, consider them like enemies, and I don't blame them. But I was getting ready to go up to Paul's house. He lived just a couple houses up the block there in East Hartford, Connecticut, up from the pastor's parsonage there in a residential neighborhood. And so I was going to go up there and start partying again. And my mother said, Mark, please sit down. I want to talk to you. And I kind of sensed what she was going to bring up. Sure enough, I set the crutches aside. I sat down on the couch. And she said, Mark, please don't go back to this lifestyle. Jesus saved your life. Don't go back to this self-destructive, habitual lifestyle that you have chosen. Give your heart to Jesus.
Did her appeal make any sense to you?
Well, you know, I sensed that the Holy Spirit was working in my heart, but I just kept thinking, I want to be with my friends. I want to be with my friends, and I want to party. And so I kept hardening my heart. I kept resisting the Holy Spirit. So another quick episode that deals with my friend Paul. On one occasion, Paul said, hey, Fox, let's take some LSD together. I said, you're crazy. I will never touch that stuff. I would do other more mild drugs like marijuana and so forth. But I said, there's no way. Well, he said, look, and this was the clincher. This is what tipped the balances. He said, I'll take it with you. I said, all right, give it to me. I'll take it. Now, he was trying to talk me into taking what is known as, and I hope you know nothing about this junk, but he said, let's take four-way blotter acid. This is the kind of hallucinogenic, potent drug that you are to split in four sections and take it at intervals spanning several days over like a weekend, and do not mix it with alcohol. Well, I took the whole thing together and I mixed it with alcohol. And I will tell you that I was in for an incredible, horrific, nightmare journey.
Well, there have been fatalities as a result of that, haven't there?
People have committed suicide as a result. Art Linkletter's daughter committed suicide as a result of overdosing on LSD. And that night, I was hallucinating, I told my friend Paul, I'm not going to go home in this condition. Can I stay overnight? So I tried to go to sleep. We went upstairs to his bedroom. I lay down and I closed my eyes, and I saw all of a sudden satanic images rushing into my mind. And I was scared to death. I just practically leaped from the bed. And I thought, I'm not going to try to go to sleep anytime soon. And I said, Paul, when am I going to come down? He said, don't worry about it. I said, did you take this stuff? He said, no, now let me go to sleep. So that night, I paced the floor in his bedroom, just a couple houses up the block from the pastor's, you know, parsonage. And I paced the floor. And I cried. I didn't want to go home because I didn't want my parents to see me in this condition.
But you knew you were a prodigal.
Oh, yeah. And I knew my parents loved me. I didn't know what to do. I was torn. I didn't want them to see me in this condition. I was scared to go home, so I just paced the floor all that night watching my friend sleep. It was a long night. And at the crack of dawn, I shook him vigorously, and he reluctantly got up, and I hallucinated all that day. It was a nightmare. And then that evening, I became the joke of the party. Hey, Fox, you haven't come down yet. Fox, you haven't come down yet. And I thought, I got to get out of here. So I stumbled out of their party room. Fox, where are you going? Where are you going? Come back. I had made up my mind. I'm going home.
Now, these are your friends confronting you and making fun, actually, of your condition, which they could identify with.
Well, at this age, it's been said friends can be cruel. And, you know, they were just joking, but it was all magnified and in my mind, my dazed mind. So as I was walking down the sidewalk amidst the dark shadows of the night, I was thinking, what am I going to say to my parents? I rang the doorbell. My older brother, Kevin, emerged. Where have you been? I said, don't worry about it. And made a beeline for my bedroom down the hallway, at the end of the hallway. Next to my parents' room was my bedroom. I went in there, and then I heard my mother coming. Mark, where have you been? We've been worried about you. I'm sorry, Mom. I was just up Paul's house. And then I started shaking. Mark, sit down. There were two twin beds. We sat down on the edge of one of them. Mark, what's the matter? My mother was quick to see something was wrong, and I just began to cry. And I clutched her arm, and I said, Mom, please help me. I've taken LSD, and I can't come down. Please help me. My father came into the bedroom. What happened? My mother shared it with him. He gasped, called the doctor. What do we do? Well, you can bring him here and we'll put him in a completely enclosed padded room until he comes down. That way, if he becomes violent, he'll be safe. Mm-hmm. My father pictured me in a claustrophobic padded room, and my dad made the right choice. He said, Doc, no, we're not going to bring him there. He's not violent. And doctor, we believe in the power of prayer.
But you could have become violent, and people have been in that circumstance.
Yes. So they were observing me. They could tell that I was very docile, scared to be sure. But meanwhile, my mother's intuition was in full gear, and she says, you got to eat. So she made me some supper. She had me put on my pajamas. I ate a little bit of food. And I believe that this helped to absorb some of the toxicity of this.
No doubt.
But it didn't deliver me. For that, my parents said, get in bed now. And my parents came by my bedside, and they prayed for me. They held tenaciously onto my clammy hands, and they prayed for me. And Henry, while they prayed for me, I knew in my mind, if Jesus does not answer their prayer, I will never get my mind back. Because I remembered that there were different friends and acquaintances that I had that had taken drugs like this, and they were never the same. They had lost their mind. I thought I would be another statistic. Well, after my parents prayed, I motioned to my mother, Mom, come here. And my mother said, what, honey? Could you stay in the bedroom here with me tonight? She said, sure. There were two twin beds. She got in the other twin bed. The lights were turned out. And so I tried to go to sleep. And all of a sudden, those satanic images swirled again in my mind. And I said, Mommy, you're there. Mommy, you're there. And she said, Mark, honey, I'll be here tonight. You can go to sleep. We prayed, Mark. God has heard our prayer. You're going to be okay. And, you know, the Bible says, Henry, in Isaiah 66, verse 13, as a mother comforts her children, so I will comfort you. And the Bible says, weeping may tarry for a night, but joy comes in the morning, Psalms 30, verse 5. And so my parents prayed, and I went to sleep. And when I awoke in the morning, the first thing that was on my mind, am I all right? Did I get my mind back? Can I think clear? Am I going to have flashbacks or withdrawals? What am I going to feel? What am I going to think? And I went to the mirror, and I was thinking, I think I'm okay. Yeah, I think. And I ran down the hallway. Mom, Dad, and they come running up the stairs. Mark, are you okay? I said, Mom, Dad, I feel great. No flashbacks, no withdrawal symptoms. My mind clear as a bell.
That's remarkable.
What do you think they said to me?
What did they say? God answers prayer.
Exactly. They said, Henry, they said, Mark, God has heard our prayers. Give your heart to Jesus. I wish I could say I gave my heart to Jesus, but it would take many episodes.
Even then, you still were reluctant. You still chose that path of a prodigal.
The devil tried to take my life. The devil tried to take my mind, and he tried to take a whole lot of other things. I almost went to jail for 3 to 5 years.
I was about to ask, what else happened in your life?
Well, without going into detail about that episode, I just began to continue to hang around the wrong group of young people.
How old were you at the time?
I was, 17 years old, 16, 17 years old. And my lawyer told me, because I made some mistakes, he said, you may get 3 to 5 years in jail. But my parents solicited the church members to pray for me. And so my parents escorted me to the West Hartford courtroom and to show their support. And so they escorted me into the courtroom. And when the judge came in, everybody stood at attention. And I'm trying to size up the judge, trying to think, oh boy, what's going to happen to me? And then I heard Mark Fox echo in the court. My name was called, and that echoed in the courtroom. And I, with my heart in my hand, I walked before the judge's bench. And I thought, oh boy, what's going to happen now?
And what did
judge,
happen?
Henry, the judge said, I don't like what I'm about to do, but I don't see any other alternative. Because the people have not come to press charges against you, this case is dismissed. You may leave.
Man, that's remarkable news.
I felt like I was floating out of the courtroom, Henry. What do you think my parents said when I got back in the car with them?
Well, I'd think they'd say, you certainly don't deserve that, but...
Exactly. They said, Mark, give your heart to Jesus. Give your heart to Jesus. And what really began to turn things around is I met a girl that I wanted to marry. And I decided to quit smoking, quit drinking, quit drugs for the relationship, thinking that that would help her to forget about an old boyfriend or about any other guy and would want to marry me. God had better plans. Didn't end up marrying her, but what happened is that I told her, remember, I didn't do it for God. I didn't quit all of the drugs or drinking. I did it for this girl. She didn't even ask me to, but I thought maybe this will help our relationship.
But you did it on short notice.
I did it cold turkey, just like that.
That's remarkable.
And as I look back, I have to give the glory to Jesus.
Absolutely.
And my parents' prayers. And so what happened is I said, we got to go to church. And she said, okay. So we started going back to church. And I was thinking, I hope she gets converted because then we can both do this together. I didn't want to go ahead of her, though. I wanted to wait for her first. And then we got a brochure in the mail. I should say my parents got a brochure in the mail from a colleague of my father's, Mark Finley. Mark Finley was holding evangelistic meetings called Radiant Living Seminars in Springfield, Massachusetts at a civic center. It was 45 minutes away, and I told this girl, let's go to these meetings. So we faithfully went to these meetings, and I was hoping, I hope she gets it. Now, the Holy Spirit was tugging on my heart as I heard Mark preach, and Mark knew about me because in 1975, he held an evangelistic series with my father in Hartford, Connecticut. And at that time, I was at my worst. My parents had kicked me out of the house because I was on drugs all the time, bad influence on my brothers. So when I showed up at his meetings, I'm sure he was surprised, and they did put forth great effort, he and the whole team, to try to reach out to me. On one occasion, he said, Mark, as he was shaking hands at the door, he said, Mark, can you stay by a little bit? And after the people left, we sat down at the edge of the stage, and he read to me Joel 2:25. I will restore to you all the years which the swarming locust hath eaten. And he said, Mark, you give your heart to Jesus, he'll restore you. I wish I could say I did it right then and there, but shortly after that, the Lord would lead me away from this girl and would lead me to accept Christ fully as my Lord and Savior.
Well, I look forward to hearing about that. And I recognize that God has something in store for each one of us.
Amen.
Even when we've turned our heart away from him.
Amen.
And made poor choices. The prodigal in the scripture is a good example of that.
Amen.
You know, there may be people that would like to hear your story. Have you anything to suggest that whereby they might be able to get information on your career and what you're doing and the gospel?
Sure. If they would like a free DVD, that there's actually two programs that encompass the totality of my conversion story. If they would like a free DVD entitled Pastor's Prodigal Comes Home, Part 1 and Part 2, they can simply call our toll-free number, and that number is 1-855-336-FREE. That's 855-336-FREE. And they can also go to our website, foreverfreeministries.org, foreverfreeministries.org.
Well, if you have been inspired by what you've heard, and you can look here on the set and see a man in his right mind who is dedicated to the Lord and using the talents he has, his memory and his initiative and the willingness to spread the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ across the country, you can call and get one of those albums and enjoy what you can do and make some decisions on your own part to be able to make the same kind of choice. If you've had some of the results of bad choices like Mark has done, just think, God's got something really good in store for you.
Amen.
Thank you so very much for coming on the program today and for your willingness to share.
Thank you, Henry.